You go to Berlin,
turn on the way. Neem een foto zien.
Ik ben niet zo iemand die snel foto's aan anderen laat zien. Ik vind het moeilijk om er iets over te zeggen. Waarom heb ik deze foto zo genomen en die weer anders? Vaak weet ik dat niet precies, ook omdat ik nog kort bezig ben. Wat ik in ieder geval zeker weet, is dat heel veel van de locatie afhangt en van degene die je fotografeert. Verder werk ik vooral vanuit mijn intuïtie.
Everything she needs. No shit. $100 fine in New York for allowing your dog to shit on the goddamn sidewalk. That's the truth. You know, pedestrians' rights as people. You're not supposed to be able to walk through a minefield every day.
Jeffrey Pierce, begin jaren 80 aanvoerder van de Gun Club, sleutelband van de Amerikaanse gitaarscene. Minstens één briljante LP, de Las Vegas Story uit 1984. Daarna solo, minder succesvol en enigszins een lage wal. Maar sinds kort weer van de drank af.
Just going to flash now because it's too dark.
Dit bakje, in dit badje, hebben al heel wat beroemdheden gelegen. Water spoelen ze in.
Ja?
En dan gaan ze hier in de, door dit luik in de droger. En dan komen ze daar droog uit.
Ik zie wat foto's van het Debbie Harry concert liggen.
Ja. Ja.
Ook wat die dan niet gelukt zijn, daar, hier.
Even kijken hoor.
Of nou?
Ja, dat is dan niet, nee. Dat,
die zijn het niet geworden, of wel?
Nee. Dat vond ik...
Het is wel erg...
Somber, hè?
Boos.
Ja, ja nou... Dit vind ik lelijk.
Ja?
Dat is wel scherp, zie je, dat handje. Ja. Dat is niet zo scherp, maar dat handje is dan wel scherp. En het is ik vind het een lelijk handje. Ja, nee, daar ben ik bekend om live foto's. Dat is zo. Jeffrey Pierce. Die moest ik nog even afdrukken vandaag.
Ja. Hey. Nou, dat is, wanneer was dat? Deze nou. Foto?
83, schat ik.
Ja?
Ja. Ik weet ook niet of iedereen reduceert, maar dat is dus echt heel belangrijk.
Ja?
Ja. Nee, iedere foto heeft wel iets waar je een beetje bij kunt kunt stellen. Kijk, je ziet hier, zie je dus een wit stukje. Wat een beetje disharmonieert met de rest.
Ja.
En dat is omdat er nog een stevige korrel in zit. En dat heeft dit niet. Is het heel moeilijk omdat een beetje grijs te krijgen. Maar daar ga je ook van uit dat het in druk moet gaan verschijnen. Dan in dat geval. En dan...
Wat dan?
Nou ja, dan is het niet zo belangrijk. Nou, dat gaat wel.
Ja.
Dat kan wel. Ja. Nou, zo doe je het. Soms haal je gewoon onwillige witte stukjes. Die haal je weg. Of je zet, zoals hier bijvoorbeeld, dat had ik ook nog kunnen doen. Je zet hier een... tandjes even een beetje los.
Ja?
Zo.
Gaat wel ver, vind ik.
Nee, dat vind ik. Nee, vind ik niet. Dat zit er toch? Dit is. Dat kan natuurlijk ook iedereen. Maar toen ze het.
Do you remember what you liked specifically about Blondie?
I liked surf songs and things like that. And that cheesy American pop, you know, that sort of. I fought the law, but the law won type songs. Bobby Fuller type songs. And because I heard all that music when I was young, when I was a kid, but I guess I was too young, you know, in the 60s to really think about who it was or what it was, you know. So it's sort of like rediscovered it that way. I was here for some business meetings and things like this because I'm trying to find a European deal. And ran into these guys from this television station.
Jeffrey used to come to our hotel room and he used to sort of run this fan club for Blondie in the early days, and we used to have to throw him out of the hotel room.
I didn't know where to go.
Why did you have to throw him out?
Well, because he wouldn't leave.
He would just sit there.
He would just sit there.
Oh, that's what I was referring to. Jeffrey did not have any career at that time and was
very tenacious,
just
though,
like,
hey,
you know,
Ronnie.
Floating how teenager, wondering what to do in life. And he figured out how to do music, and it's been an uphill battle ever since.
I used to stay around all the time, yeah. My parents are getting divorced, and I couldn't go home. They're fighting. And I go try them, you know. And usually I never can remember exactly how they're done. But sometimes I can get a good idea that way, too. I'll just distort what I think they sound like. Tried to hawk that off to him.
What did he say then? What did he say when he...
I don't know, he was... think he was drunk or something. Yeah. I think we just sat around howling or something for like about 10, 15 minutes and then just... That's all we did. I think he said he liked it, but I think we all forgot it after because we were just bummed, you know? Yeah. I used to make them up like, I used to always just, whenever I made up something, I used to just, you know, go hawk it on the text and the horse sets, you know? Like, oh, we're gonna play Ain't That Peculiar like this, you know? Robinson songs are kind of closet blues songs too. So we just changed it to like straight off Delta Howlin' Wolf song. You know, should change it to Howlin' Wolf. But I heard love ain't that peculiar. Alvin and the Blasters got me hooked on it, and then, and Bob Height, late of Canned Heat. Bob Height, like, you know, had us over the house a few times, just showed us incredibly wonderful records that just simply were not available or in print, and there was no way to obtain them. And you know, he just sort of created like the whole fascination with finding a undiscovered products. It's like archaeology in a way, I guess. We would buy stuff strictly only on the basis of the title. It looked like it might be a blues record. Don Waller, who wrote a book about Motown, was a real close friend of mine. A big influence at the start of the band, getting us into the whole darkness surrounding Robert Johnson and all these things. All these things that sounds pretty exciting to a bunch of young musicians. Peace blues! And Bob Height used to tell me about, like, oh yeah, we took a trip to Alabama, and he goes, and we found, we took a trip to Alabama, we found an old record distribution warehouse that I'd read about, you know, which used to put out a lot of Ace and Sun and records of this sort. We thought we'd have a look in there. He goes, and they go through this old warehouse, and the records are all still in there. It's just this warehouse. No one's ever cleaned it out. No one wants to clean out a bunch of 78s. It's heavy. You know, so no one's ever done it. So he says, he goes, and it was just like mountains. We had to like crawl over the records. And he's going, I had to get to those blues sites because I was looking for Rube Lacey, Ham Hound Crave. You know, he's telling us all this. And he goes, it was way in the back of the place. I was sure. He goes, he's digging through it. And I was going, well, what else is there? What else did you see? He goes, oh, there's a lot of Sun records. He says, because I wasn't even paying attention to Sun records, man. We just break that stuff when we're walking across to try to get to the blues records.
You're the meanest girl ever see.
From a musical point of view on your own career from the last 10 years? I'm still pretty dissatisfied with it. I think I'm just too young when I started or something. There's a lot of things I did now I wouldn't do in retrospect.
Where are you from, Patricia?
Los Angeles.
And how long have you been with the band?
With Gun Club about a year. I knew Jeffrey before that, and I knew the other members that were in the band in the past, and that's how I got in it.
Patricia, what could you say about the musical concept of the Gun Club?
As far as I know, there isn't one. It keeps changing. I've been in it, with the other two members, and it was completely different. This is getting, it's getting wackier and wackier. It's getting, I don't know, when somebody asks what this is like, I can't answer.
Whack.
Like a lot of bands, we went through our whole drug period, and that all ended though quite a while ago.
Yeah.
At least as far as I know, it did. and then after that, we thought we were behaving really well by just being alcoholics, but then we actually had found out we had to stop that too. That one and Somebody's in My Home.
This band plays is so nice.
Yeah, they have like a really strange timing.
Yeah.
Because all the songs are such really out there songs.
You can't defend that.
Like, post-war blues, he's like my favorite guy. I mean, he's the one who's most completely out. I mean, he's somewhat way out in some weird deep jungle or something. Everybody else, like, seems to be, like, aware of what's going on, you know, just sort of slickness and professionalism and a lot of, like, Chicago stuff. Howlin' Wolf is still way back in the woods. So yeah. Doesn't even, you know.
He's dying all the time in the woods.
Yeah.
Like, fucking hell, what's happening here?
Don't you think that whole drug and alcohol thing also had a very bad influence on your creative career, don't you think?
Sure. There's a lot of decisions you made that were just absolutely idiotic. Or were under the influence of another influence. That stuff influences everything. It influences your decisions, your behavior, the way you walk, your relationships. Not just the way people perceive you. It influences everything. You can't be really creative. Then you think 30 minutes of, you know, a horrible version of A Love Supreme played on guitar is really great. No. I listen to it now, I go, ah! What was I doing?
I'm going down the river of sadness. I'm going down the river of pain. In the dark under the wires, I gave you the key to the highway and the key to my motel door. So the thought of leaving and leaving, I won't be back no more. Oh, my dark-eyed friend, I'm recalling you again. Soft voices that speak nothing to you.